David McGee and Cross the Bridge want to bless you and help you. We have a series that will improve your relationship with God, improve your relationship with family and loved ones, and help you understand the Bible more. We are offering the greatest gift. This is sure to help you as well as bless you and those around you. So don't wait. Call now. Operators are standing by now, waiting on your call to get you this series that will help you know the love you are looking for. If you order in the next hour, we will include a free surprise gift, our way of saying thanks. So call now or go online and order now, and don't wait. Haven't you waited long enough to know more love?
We've put together, especially for you, a teaching package through 1 Corinthians 13. Now, we've spent hours of teaching and encouraging information in there. So let me encourage you to get this package to help you to both love other people more and to be loved more. And you'll be encouraged as you do. Thanks so much.
Welcome to Cross the Bridge with David McGee. Let's join Pastor David now as he continues his verse-by-verse teaching of God's Word.
The title of today's message is Bodybuilding. Bodybuilding. So, and it's not the kind of bodybuilding you're thinking about. It's kind of a play on words, because this is a body. The people who are joining with us in fellowship, they can be in South Africa, they can be in Europe, they can be around the world. But if they're part of us, they're part of this body. Amen? And the body is to be built up. Now, the cool thing about this type of bodybuilding is, you know, you don't even do it with your arms or your legs. It doesn't make you sore. You use your mouth to do this bodybuilding. How cool is that? Some of you have been waiting for some type of mouth calisthenics to do bodybuilding. Well, here it is, man. So you can do this, and it's kind of like that thing of, you know, started working out, and I took, started with 10-pound sacks of potatoes, you know, and lifting them and holding them for about 5 minutes. Then I went to 25-pound bag of potatoes, holding them for about 5 minutes, went to 50-pound bags of potatoes, and then went to 100-pound, the sack of potatoes. And just last week, I started putting potatoes in them. That's your kind of bodybuilding, isn't it? So, you know, this chapter, and at first glance, a lot of people think this chapter is all about tongues. It's really not, once you start reading and digging into it. Now, it speaks about tongues, and let's all understand that is a scriptural thing that we need to discuss. It's in here, and we need to take a scriptural look at what it says. And let's jump in there. Verse 4 says, "He who speaks in a tongue edifies himself. But he who prophesies edifies the church." So it's kind of interesting, because right off here, verse 4, he's talking about this balance of being personally edified or built up or encouraged, and we should be, and also building up the church, which we should be. See, and let's understand that there's a balance between those two things. There's things, you know, we're talking about exercise, and exercise is good, but you know, if you over-exercise, it will kill you. Eating is good, but if you overeat, it could kill you. If you take medications, if you take too many of them, it can kill you. So the question is a question of balance, if you will. Of balance between personally being edified and, you know, edifying the church. And notice as we go through here, Paul never says don't use the gifts. He says use them in a balanced way. And on the New Living Translation, this verse says, "A person who speaks in tongues is strengthened personally, but one who speaks a word of prophecy strengthens the entire church." So the Bible says that if somebody speaks in a tongue, if you have that gift, this unknown prayer language or heavenly language or whatever title you want to give it, that it personally edifies you spiritually, okay? But that it really doesn't do anything for the body. Now, Paul doesn't say that's absolutely wrong. You don't need personal edification, because you do. But he says there's a balance between personal edification and strengthening the body. Now, Again, we need each personally to be edified, to be built up. And, you know, at first, when we first become a Christian, we're really dependent upon other people a lot. God sets it up like that. We're dependent upon other people to hear the gospel. I mean, it's probably, there's a rare testimony that somebody just opened the Bible, read it, and got saved. But most of us, there was somebody there that told us the good news, that shared it with us, and God used them. And then if that person stuck around, then we would ask them questions. Hey, what does this mean? And what does this verse mean? And what does that verse mean? But over time, what happens is we begin to read the Bible, we begin to understand the Bible, and we're not as dependent on other people. Now, when you get towards that, let's understand there's a responsibility. And we need to be careful. You know, as a church, God keeps speaking these four words, grow up and build up. Grow up and build up. And here's what I mean by that. You know, if you've been here for months or years, part of what you need to be doing is looking around, not just going, well, who's I need somebody to disciple me. I need somebody taking care of me. It's all about me. You need to be saying, you know, where's somebody else I can disciple? Who's around that I can disciple? See, because you get to a certain level spiritually, and gang, you'll stop growing if you don't start pouring out to other people. Amen? Yes. And we need to be careful because, yes, I want you to be careful with you being built up and edified. That's why I want you in the Bible every day. That's why we send out these email devotionals. We call them evotionals. We'll mail them to you. Why? Because I understand you need personal edification every day. But also as you grow, look to build up the body and look to build up others. Amen? And this is what Paul's saying here. He's saying, look, there's a balance here of being built up personally and building up others. Why? Because the body, and this is an amazing thing, the body of Christ, indestructible, needs building up. Well, why is that? What is the body of Christ? It's you and me. And we're people. And even the strongest spiritual person sometimes needs encouragement and needs building up. Amen? I mean, sometimes you're beat up, and it's amazing. Because one thing, when you're beat up and feeling down, you need to be here. Now, that's not your first inclination. When you get beat up or anxious or depressed, your first move is to pull back from church. Don't do it. That's a strategy of the enemy. Why? Because he knows if you come here, you're going to be encouraged. You're going to walk through the door and somebody's going to say, man, it's so good to see you. And that right there can lift your countenance, having somebody encourage you from this place. And we all need encouragement. I need encouragement. Of course, we need to seek our encouragement first and foremost in God. Because there will be times when nobody else is around. And when you need that encouragement, you go to the throne. You don't go to the phone. Amen? So we're the church, the body is made up of people. People need encouragement, so the body needs encouragement. So whose responsibility is it to build up the body and encourage the body? Well, it should be just the senior pastor. He's a professional Christian. We all pay him to be spiritual. That's who's supposed to encourage all of us. No. The body itself is supposed to encourage the body. Now, this is so cool. You know why? Because have you ever been really bummed out or down or freaked out or whatever, and then you take the time and make the effort to encourage somebody else? And interestingly, what happens? You get encouraged. So as you encourage other people, you are encouraged and built up and lifted up. So some of you that are walking around discouraged, let me encourage you to encourage others and watch what happens. Because you can't get into this little self-pity vicious cycle. Nobody encourages me, nobody encourages me, nobody encourages me, but you don't encourage anybody else, and you continue that cycle. And let's understand that we're all responsible for this building up of the body. As a matter of fact, that's the first life lesson. We are all responsible for strengthening the church, encouraging one another, and comforting one another. We are all responsible for strengthening the church, encouraging one another, and comforting one another. Now, when I say that, don't feel like you're burdened and, oh my goodness, now I got something else to do. No, friend, this is so easy. As a matter of fact, one of the reasons I share, you know, I just shared about people getting saved and people viewing the live stream. I shared about these folks, lost loved ones getting saved. Why did I do that? To encourage you. See, somebody else simply getting saved, asking God to forgive them of their sins, encourages you and I. And then we can turn around and share that with somebody. Hey, did you hear that, you know, two people got saved through the radio ministry? These people got saved here, these people. Then there's this cycle of encouragement, of us strengthening each other, of us comforting one another. And of course, let's understand, there's the flip side of discouraging one another, of making each other anxious, of not comforting one another. And let's understand, have you ever thought about how easy it is to freak somebody else out? It's really pretty easy, isn't it?
Yes.
And is that really is? Amen, brother. Is that what somebody in here is being honest? Amen. Is that sense of discouraging somebody else, is that a gift? No. I told my kids earlier, because, you know, kids are kids. They love freaking each other out. And, you know, I mean, I was watching my kids one day, and Ashley was in this building phase where she was building blocks, and Johnny was in this destructo phase, you know, and so she's building stuff. He's hammering it all down, and Ben was in the diaper stage. But, and I went to Johnny. I said, Johnny, look, man, you know, freaking your sister out, that's not really a gift. I know it might be fun from time to time, but what you really need to work and cultivate is a gift of settling her when she gets anxious, of encouraging her when she's discouraged. That's a gift that God wants to use throughout your life with everybody you come in contact with. Amen? So this is a gift we all need to cultivate to encourage each other and to be passionate about what we do. Because, gang, if you're not passionate about telling somebody about the gospel, telling somebody about the good news, they're not going to be interested. If you're not passionate about inviting them to church, they're not going to be interested. You know, if your invitation to church goes something like this, listen, I go to this church, and it's too big, the music's too loud, he talks too long, but I don't know, you want to go? No, I think I'm good. No, seriously, you can come and get, you know, the joy of the Lord or whatever. Man, it looks like you cornered the market on the joy, dude. I don't know if I could stand that much joy. Or if your invitation is like, man, you ought to come to this place. It's awesome. God is doing such an incredible work. People are getting saved and being discipled, and we're learning the Bible. You want to come? Well, okay. You see, you get caught up in that. Amen? And actually, the word, do you realize, and we talk about passion, we talk about enthusiasm. Do you realize the word enthusiasm, where it comes from? Enthusiasm is from the Greek, entaltheos. It literally means being filled with God. Theos means God. Entheos, enthused, is being filled with God. So we should be filled with God. We should be enthusiastic. We should be encouraged. Now, can we all be, you know, encouraged at the same time? No, not usually. So what do? Well, then now we're part of a body where maybe when you're going through a tough week, somebody else is having a great week, and they can encourage you and pray for you. And that's where when somebody's, even, you know, that when somebody's weak, somebody else can be strong. Somebody else can pray for them. Somebody else can encourage them. And this verse does remind us that we need to be concerned about both, being personally edified and edifying the body. Number one, being personally edified or built up. It's another thing that we say. Or building up the church. Because God's plan ultimately is that you do both. Is that you're personally built up, and then you also build up the body. Because part of this discipleship of following the Lord is not being completely consumed with self, but being concerned about others. Not being consumed with self, but concerned about others. You know, I've had to learn that as a pastor. You know, there is a balance. If every time I read, and I'm in danger of doing, you know, when I read the Bible and I find something cool, I go, oh, gotta go tell them this. And occasionally God will say to me, that's not for them, that's for you. Oh, okay. See, because there is the balance. In ministry, sometimes you can focus too much on edifying the body, and it ends up to be a train wreck in your personal life. I mean, not my life. I've heard stories of other people's life that have this issue. So you want to be sure that both are going on, that you're being personally edified and encouraged, and you're edifying and encouraging the body. Amen? Now, verse 5, you know, so for some of you that really struggle with this unknown tongue stuff, you're really going to have a hard time with this verse. Paul, verse 5, I wish you all spoke with tongues. Oh, man. That's kind of vague, isn't it? Now, does Paul mean he wishes that we all spoke more foreign languages? No. You can't. Don't twist the scriptures to make them mean what you want them to mean. Just read them and understand what they're talking about. But let's understand, in the Corinthian church, what were they doing? They were focused on self. They were focused too much on this gift of tongues. And that can happen. It happens in some churches today. They're way too focused on the gift of tongues. The service, you know, is this big parade of people standing up and speaking in tongues and interrupting the pastor and doing all this and do... I don't believe that's scriptural. As a matter of fact, in this chapter, Paul's trying to give us the balance of what's supposed to be going on. And let's read on in verse 5. I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesy. For he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks with tongues, unless indeed he interprets that the church may receive edification. Now, we encourage the small groups if somebody feels like they got a verse to share or a word from God or maybe even this gift of tongues, and then somebody else has the interpretation, that's valid. But outside of that, this unknown tongue is used for a personal prayer language and really is not appropriate for public display, if you will. That's why we, and in verse 5 it says prophecy is... it's greater. Now, again, what is prophecy? Prophecy is speaking to people on behalf of God. Okay, interceding is speaking to God on behalf of people. So when I'm up here teaching, in essence, I am prophesying. Okay, I'm not necessarily telling you the future, but I'm speaking on behalf of God to people. And this verse says that is greater than this display of an unknown language or a tongue. Okay, that's why we don't allow interruptions during the service, because God's Spirit is using me, speaking through me to you. So if somebody stood up in the middle of service and tried to give an unknown language or a tongue, you know, one of the leaders would say, hey, listen, you know, that's not appropriate. Why? God doesn't interrupt himself. If he's speaking through me, he's speaking through me. Okay, so, and later on, Paul in this chapter says, look, if somebody comes in and you got all this stuff going on, unbelievers are going to think you're crazy. I've been to those churches where, you know, I would invite an unbeliever, pandemonium would, you know, break out, and I didn't even want to look at the guy, you know, because I knew I'd look over and he'd be, can we leave now? So Paul, 2,000 years, said, look, it was happening in the Corinthian church. It's still happening today. But let's understand, too, what was at the heart of the Corinthian church? What was the real issue? You know, if you think about it, it's interesting. They were being spiritually selfish. Spiritually selfish. Is that possible? Well, yeah, it is. Because if you, while I just encourage you to be built up personally, encouraged and spend time with the Lord every day, you can get to a place where you're spiritually selfish. Well, what does that look like? Well, if you weigh every event and every day by how it affects you spiritually, then you may have crossed the line into being spiritually selfish. Let's understand that if I want to be personally edified, or, you know, I could spend days on end in prayer and days on end just reading the Bible and never coming up here and teaching it. And I would be really built up. What would be missing? I wouldn't be building the body up. And so when you start to look at every function of the church, of how it affects me, you probably, or if you've hadn't crossed the line, you're flirting with that spiritually selfish line. And this is part of what I'm talking about. You know, we've been teaching the Word. Some people have been here for years. They're learning the Word, and it's so important to begin to grow up and begin caring for others and not be totally consumed with being personally spiritually edified. Because, see, here's what will happen. If you do that, and I've used this analogy before, but, you know, it's like a bird bath. A bird bath receives water in but never pours it back out. What does a bird bath end up looking like? Green, slimy, stinky, nasty? I don't want you spiritually to look like that bird bath. I want you to look like a stream that's poured into and then it pours out. And what happens is if you become too spiritually selfish, it'll boomerang on you and you'll wind up dry as a bone spiritually. Now, what happens at that point? Do people repent and say, oh my goodness, I've become consumed with self? No, to be honest, a lot of times they start looking around and blaming other people. Well, it's because of this. Well, it's because of that. And it's because he's not doing this, or she's not doing that, or he said this, or she said that. When they really need to come to the point to realize, you know what? It's not about me anymore. And again, you know, I was talking about building others up. Because when you build up the church and you're part of the church, guess what happens? You're built up. So it's not like I'm saying everybody needs to, you know, sacrificially always be building up the church. Because if you're part of the church and you're building up the church, guess what happens? Again, it's God has arranged it in such a way, it's awesome, that you're built up as you encourage, when you encourage others. Again, I'm using encourage, and what does that mean? Well, in means to fill with courage. When I encourage you, I'm filling you with courage. When you encourage me, you're filling me with courage. Why is that so important? Because a lot of the rest of the world is trying to discourage you in your spiritual faith. They're trying to tear you down from following Jesus. You know what I'm talking about. Some of your family, some of your friends, some of your coworkers. And maybe that's not this diabolical thing of wanting to strip your faith from you. It's just what happens because they don't believe like you do. So you got all these people gathered around you trying to tear you down and bum you out. And then you got the body of Christ, which is a place where we should be built up. Another couple words that you'll see in this chapter a lot is edify or exhort. And you'll hear me just define that simply as to build up. To build up. Friend, if you're out there and you want to ask God to forgive you, maybe for the first time, or maybe you've been freshly convicted about not building up the body, let me encourage you to pray with me. I'm going to ask that you pray out loud. It's a short, simple prayer, just telling God you're sorry and asking him to forgive you for the things you've done. Let me encourage you to ask God to forgive you, because it can be a life-changing thing. Can make all the difference. And you're why we do what we do. So please pray with me right now out loud. Whether you're up front or still seated or listening from somewhere else, pray with me. Dear Jesus, I believe you died for me so that I could be forgiven. And I believe you were raised from the dead so that I could have a new life. And God, I've done wrong things. And I am sorry. Please forgive me of all those things. Give me the power to follow you all of my days. In Jesus' name.
If you've prayed this prayer with Pastor David, he would love to hear from you and help you get off to a good start as a follower of Christ. We'd love to bless you with a new believer's kit, absolutely free. So please call us now or write to let us know. You've just made the greatest decision you'll ever make.
Congratulations to those people who just asked God to forgive them. Awesome decision. You know, I want to encourage you, as you hear these teachings, to apply them to your life. I've dedicated myself to helping share the truths of the Bible, to help you deal with life, and to discover the abundant life that Jesus talks about and offers to each and every one of you. I also want to invite you to get a free email devotional that I send out every day. Just go to crossthebridge.com, put in your email, and I'll send you an email every day to encourage you. Hey friend, I'd love for you to come join us here Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. And also you can watch live stream Thursdays at 7 or Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. Also check out the website at crossthebridge.com. Do you know and love people that don't know Jesus as their Savior? You know, I want to join with you in praying for these people. I've got hundreds of people that are committed to praying for them as well, for them to come to a saving knowledge of Jesus. Go to crossthebridge.com, put in their first names, and I'll be praying for them, and these hundreds of folks will be praying for those people to come to know Jesus. Take the time to do this. It's really important.
David McGee and Cross the Bridge want to bless you and help you. We have a series that will improve your relationship with God, improve your relationship with family and loved ones, and help you understand the Bible more. We are offering the greatest gift. This is sure to help you as well as bless you and those around you. So don't wait. Call now. Operators are standing by now, waiting on your call to get you this series that will help you know the love you are looking for. If you order in the next hour, we will include a free surprise gift, our way of saying thanks. So call now or go online and order now, and don't wait. Haven't you waited long enough to know more love?
We've put together, especially for you, a teaching package through 1 Corinthians 13. Now, we've spent hours of teaching and encouraging information in there. So let me encourage you to get this package to help you to both love other people more and to be loved more. And you'll be encouraged as you do. Thanks so much.